wrap up this conference, Reform and a Revolution, Imagining a World with Transformative Justice. You're going to hear from three great speakers, then a conversation, and then you're participating. There's going to be cards that are sent around, and I hope you write down your comments or particularly questions on the cards so that we can share them with the panelists.
You're welcome.
Kashama Savant isn't here now because she spoke last night. Kashama, a.k.a. Rick Wolf, though, is. And have you noticed you never seen them in the same place at the same time? A new form of transforming here. But Rick Wolf, I've introduced many times on Democracy Now. He is the longtime economist at the University of Massachusetts Amherst for decades, left there, came to New York, is now at the New School. Has written a number of books, including Capitalism Hits the Fan, and the most recent one, Democracy at Work, A Cure for Capitalism. He'll be speaking first. He'll be followed by Rob Robinson, who is a member of the leadership committee of the Take Back the Land movement and a staff volunteer at the National Economic and Social Rights Initiative. After losing his job in 2001, with a Fortune 500 company, he spent 2 years homeless on the streets of Miami and 10 months in a New York City shelter. He eventually overcame homelessness, has been in the housing movement in New York City since 2007. In the fall of 2009, Rob was chosen to be New York City chair of the first ever official mission of a UN Special Rapporteur on the right to adequate housing. He's worked with homeless people in Budapest, Hungary, in Berlin, is connected with housing movements in South Africa and Brazil. He works with the European Squatters Collective, the International Alliance of Inhabitants, Landless Peoples Movement, and the Movement of People Affected by Dams, and is a member of the Steering Committee of the USA-Canada Alliance of Inhabitants. He's a member of the board here of Left Forum. He'll be followed by Barbara Bowen. Barbara Bowen is a professor of English at Queens College, Graduate Center, City University of New York. She taught for 15 years before becoming president of the Professional Staff Congress, CUNY. A scholar of 17th century English literature and African American studies, Professor Bowen earned her PhD at Yale. She's published numerous works. Throughout her academic career, she has worked in progressive political movements as a labor organizer and was elected president of the Professional Staff Congress, PSC, in 2000, part of the collective of faculty and staff with deep roots in progressive politics. The PSC represents 25,000 faculty members and professional staff at CUNY and the CUNY Research Foundation. A fierce opponent of accommodating to economic austerity, Professor Bowen has been an outspoken critic of Albany's failed strategy of disinvestment in CUNY and reliance on increased student tuition. We're going to begin with Rick Wolf.
Thank you all for coming and for being part of this. Before I begin my remarks, I have to say something about our modest chairwoman here, Amy Goodman. We have been growing, we're very happy to say, in the Left Forum over the last few years, and as was announced, this may indeed be our largest in terms of the thousands of you that have come out. Nothing has been more important in building the kind of awareness, commitment, consciousness, and interest of the left, in the left, than the ability for people in this country, including all of us here, to know that every single day there is a person who's going to be on the television and on the radio across this country presenting a way of understanding what's going on that is not available any other way. We all have an enormous debt. Part of our work is changing this society. And she makes that easier for us by her informing a much larger public than just us, and making it easier for them to understand what we're after and for us to make the kinds of inroads that we seek. Okay, I don't want to take more than the 5 or so minutes allotted to us, so I worked as hard as I could to try to come up with something that would express one person, me, one person's sense of what we have to do now. What a revolutionary transformation needs if one is going to be achieved in this society. And you'll pardon me for dwelling a little bit about the economics. I have been condemned to that particular discipline for most of my adult life because of unwise decisions I made as a young person. So, I see around me, as a leftist, which I am very proud to be, I see a weakened and fractured labor movement. I see a diverse set of social movements. They rise, they fall, they inspire, they depress by turns. They grow, I'm pleased about it. They try to build bridges to one another. I'm enthusiastic about it. But I, at the end of the day, know that there's lots and lots of good people working in lots and lots of different organizations, going in lots and lots of different directions. So what I think we need, above all else, is to overcome the last 50 years when it seemed that if you were on the left, that's what you would end up doing, focusing your life in some particular way on something that galvanized your excitement, that you were passionate about, whether it was in struggles against racism or sexism or homophobia or warfare around the world or the horrible treatment of people in jails, as we just heard about, and so on. I saw that and I thought that what we need now is to kind of face something we haven't been able to overcome. That kind of diverse scattering of our forces. So to make a long story short, here's what I think we need. I think we need to come together. I think we need to build a powerful, unified left organization in the United States. And I want to speak about that. I don't think, as a student of the capitalist economic system, that we can confront that system, its mechanisms, political, economic, and cultural, as an immensely diverse set of small organizations. It's just not adequate to the task. And we have to face that if indeed we're serious about fundamental social change. And I want to address what I suspect is the big concern that may be in your mind as I say this. And the way I'm going to get at it is as follows. Every large, unified, left organization has always been a complicated alliance of people with different ideas, different passions, different commitments. The notion that these big organizations are some sort of monolithically controlled is a fiction mostly produced by the enemies of left organization. Even those who wanted left organizations to be highly organized, disciplined, never achieved it, were always upset by the diversity of opinion and the diversity of commitment. So there really isn't a choice between a unified organization and diversity. The real choice is, are we going to have our different points of view and be stuck in little organizations, each with their own identity, each worried about keeping that identity separate from those of the others? Or are we going to have our diversity, because we couldn't get rid of it even if we wanted to, inside a unified organization? That's the real choice. And I think think we are now ready, and Lord knows the situation demands a new, powerful, unified left organization in the United States. I think this attendance here now, I think the kinds of audiences that Amy has generated over the years, I think the kinds of audiences I'm finding. You know, I started the radio program that you're so kind to me about 3 years ago with WBAI. That's all, just the AI, once a week. I'm now on 35 stations. We're about to start a TV version. That's not me, it's not me. No, it isn't, it's not false modesty either. That's because I have neither the staff, nor the money, nor the ability to go out and get other radio stations or television stations to come to me. They're coming on their own without me, because there's an interest and a hunger and a support. So I know this firsthand. We can move now in a way that we didn't. For the last 50 years, the pendulum swung way too far and for way too long in the direction of small, isolated, separated institutions and organizations. There's a great risk there. You end up spending too much time on the little hothouse group that you have, too much time in competitive struggles with the other little groups, appealing for funds or appealing for audience or appealing for all the other things. You know what I'm talking about. Most of you are involved in that. Just as I am. Just as I am. Imagine what would happen here in the United States if I had the following experience at the end of the talk I give. And I do a lot of it now all over the United States. I always have the same experience. If I'm lucky, I've been good that evening, a bunch of people come up to the podium at the end and they all say to me basically the same thing. What can I do? Tell me, where do I go? Where do I sign up? And I give them this sad look because I don't know what the answer to that question is. I'm no use to them at all. They can see it and I feel it. I want there to be a place for people at all different levels, just getting into it, in it for a while, deeply committed, all of it. There has to be a place where they can come, because they now number in the millions in this country. And we need to take the steps to say, we're going to build that organization, and we're going to be very respectful to the differences amongst us. To have a unified organization doesn't mean you give them up. Doesn't mean you deny that you have disagreements, that you have different priorities, that you have different things that move you. We have to build on that difference. We can't just preach the importance of diversity in every other institution while not building our own unified party that is respectful of the differences amongst us. But we'll be all better off working together on all we share with our differences, than not being together with our differences and therefore unable to move at a time when the opportunities are so rich. So for me, I want part of the everyday revolutions and transformations we take with us at the end of this conference to be a commitment to try to move in that kind of unifying direction, because I think it will inspire and energize all of us and all of what we're trying to do. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone, and again, thank you for being here. I love it. It was great that Rick prepared his statement, because I didn't prepare one and I wanted to hear what the other speakers had said before I delivered, because thinking about the theme of this conference, reform and or revolution, I think we're past the stage of reform. I think it does us no good to think about repairing a system that's been fundamentally broken since it was created, right? It just doesn't do anything for us. The one thing that I think I'm challenged with, from what, while I believe in everything Rick said, I think the way that that change has to come about, Rick, is through social movements. And I think that term, and start to throw the tomatoes at me, is jargon in this country, right? We don't understand what real social movements are. Folks saw me with folks here from Brazil, and there's a reason why you take advantage of those opportunities to go overseas and learn. In the short period of time that I've been in movements here, I couldn't understand why we couldn't come together, like Rick said. So I look at it from a different point of view. I'm in communities every day, in the city, around the country, and around the world. And I see work being done differently outside of the U.S. There is a fundamental problem in this country called exceptionalism. And it's a value system, right? We think we do everything better, right? We don't, right? We can learn from other movements, right? And why should we cast that aside? Why shouldn't we welcome those opportunities to be in spaces where folks who are facing oppression every day, right, are born into oppression, get up and rise up, right? As a community organizer, I can just imagine. I've seen scenes in Colombia where all of a sudden there was an assembly call and 5,000 people are marching to a certain space in Colombia. About 500 of those folks are barefooted and they had to walk for about 50 miles. If you go to a community organization in this country and say, we need to gather people and we need to talk about this issue and we have to go 50 miles to do it, the first thing they're gonna do, how can we charter a bus? There's no thought about walking. If it's someplace we have to stay overnight, can we get a cheap block of hotel rooms, right? So changing our way of thinking. When I was in Brazil for the Mavi National Encounter, the folks that were here last night, they moved 5,000 people to Sao Paulo. 3,000 came from the Northeast, 3,000, there were about 1,500 coming from the Northwest, traveled 3 days by bus. Those folks slept in a national park for 3 days because they knew it was important to come together and think about the work and how to build together and how to bond together. And I think through that type of bondage, you build an arc towards politicizing people. That is something that is lacking here. We are not politicized. We are not politicized, and we do not have a political honing or a way to think about this work in a real way to understand what is affecting us and how we can build together to make that true social change. That is fundamentally lacking in this country. I think the other problem that is the issue is fundamentally the money, right? Foundations and resources. Stanley mentioned this on Friday night. Rick just mentioned it. It is what is keeping us organizing in silos, right? This dependence on foundation money. We are not gonna move any work when we're working as consultants for somebody who decides what our community should look like. It just makes no sense. But we salivate for that money. We have to think differently. How can we get the resources to move work, right? And I would always argue with these community groups when I go in communities, we have to stop that reliance, and then the challenge comes back to me, how do you do it? Well, I always look at the faith community. They don't reach for foundation money. There are some that do, but the majority collect from its membership. So how do we resource our movements by charging dues to our members or collecting dues from our members, right? We need to fund our own work to make that true fundamental change. When we start to think differently, we will build a social movement. Movements in this country are something that a foundation has created, or that's the thinking that we wrap it around, right? When a foundation comes to you and says, this is what we're gonna fund, and you mobilize a couple of people within your organization to do that work, and you have certain metrics from that proposal that you submitted that they say, okay, we're gonna give you $50,000 to do this. At the end of the day, is that gonna lead to social change? And you have 1,000 organizations or 100,000 organizations around the country doing little pockets of work, it leads to nothing. All that does is divides us. It does not lead to social change. So I think I'm agreeing again with Rick. I think we have to find a way to build a national left organization to bring communities together, to politicize ourselves, to think strategically about the forces that we're working against and how we build our collectivity to push back. There was something that was told to me in October by Maloon Kathari, the former UN Special Rapporteur, on the right to adequate housing. And he made it very clear, and it reflects in the work of Mavi. He said, Rob, the oppression that we're facing is from transnational corporations and global forces. The response needs to come from global forces. The response needs to be a global response. So until we push away this exceptionalism and start to think about how we work together globally, because we're fighting the same forces, we are never going to see true social change in this country. Thank you.
Such wonderful speakers. I want to say how honored I am to be on the same platform with Rick and Rob and Amy Goodwin, all of whom have already given us a sense of how rich their thinking is tonight. And also to thank especially Kathy Mulder. She thanked everyone else, but nobody thanked her. And a special thanks to Stanley Roman, who invited me, and to the committee, who worked incredibly hard to make this happen. As Kathy said, I'm very proud to be the head of a labor movement, and the labor movement that represents the faculty and staff who work right here at the City University of New York, and a lot of you are here tonight, which is wonderful for me. So I really work within what Rick called, rightly, the weakened and fractured labor movement. And I think for me, the question is somebody who is working within that and who honors the risks that people in this room have taken with their lives, who see so clearly the risks a lot of you have taken with your lives to make change. The first thing I want to say is that I think the big news of this conference is that there are 4,500 people who came to something called Left Forum. Maybe we didn't all know what we were going to find. Maybe we came because of hope. Maybe we came because of energy. We wanted to change what was on the left. We wanted to find out what was happening in the left. We wanted to find out what the left is. Maybe we've been in the left for a long time, and we felt that we must continue to work or find that new energy. But to me, the most exciting thing in many ways is simply how many of us were drawn here. And I hope when you get a chance to write questions and comments that one of the things you talk about is what brought you here and what you are going to take away from this event. I think we have a lot to learn from each other, and I look forward to that. But for me, as somebody who made the choice, talk about, what did you call it? Misguided decisions in one's youth, to what discipline you would choose as an academic. But in many ways, you know, it was a wonderful choice for me. But made the choice first to be an academic and to teach early literature, and then made a big choice to step pretty much away from that and lead a labor union along with some of my colleagues who are right here and comrades tonight. What we stepped into, and it was not just me, we really stepped collectively together, was into imagining and trying to figure out what you can do as an organization that wants to do what we would call radical reform, that wants to participate in everyday revolutions, to use the framework of this conference, and maybe even something going beyond the everyday, but does that within an already conceived structure. What are the limits, but also the possibilities of that kind of work? Not all of us are in those organizations. Some of us are forming our own organizations. Some of us have felt, and I certainly understand this, that the existing structures are not going to bring us where we need to go. But others look to labor and think it remains the biggest organizational structure in this country in terms of possibility of being something for working people. It sits right in the belly of the beast of capitalism. If we want to talk about confronting capitalism, you might think work in a labor movement, because there you are face to face with it. And you might also think work in a labor union that works in academia or works in education, because there you confront not just the structures and the power of capitalism right across the table from you in the bargaining table, and right across the picket line from you, there it is, but you also struggle against and confront the structures of education, which are so powerful in misdirecting and limiting and rationing possibilities for people in this country in ways that remain racist and remain sexist and remain deeply oppressive to all of us, not just to those they immediately oppress. So you might think, try a labor union in the field of education to try that direct confrontation and see what the possibilities and limits of that organization are. And I would say we're still discovering them. As a group, we are still discovering the kind of things you can and cannot do with that direct confrontation with the boss. For one thing, we're in a country where the labor law is incredibly oppressive, and here's where I think we must listen to what Rahm said. We have to get beyond thinking that the only way of conceptualizing the relation of labor to the boss is the way we do it here. There are many other ways of imagining that, even within the current structures, and we need to learn from people who have done that differently. To imagine that thousands, tens of thousands of prisoners got up, as you said, Dolores, got up, rose up, and risked everything in a hunger strike is incredible. I mean, it's an amazing example of the kind of power people can have when they stand together. Learn from that when we think about the possibilities of change. We also need to think about the limits. Somebody in a labor movement and somebody who even hesitates to use the phrase movement, because I think you're completely right. The structure of labor right now is not only weakened, but it's weakened because it's fractured, and it's fractured because unions have taken the position that they represent only the people who pay them dues. Yes, we are an organization that's self-funded, but then it leads, has led in this case, I shouldn't say leads, it has led in this case to a mindset of circling the wagons and feeling that the labor union must represent only those who pay dues, must never think of itself as representing A, organized labor, or B, all working people, let alone think about working people internationally. That's why the labor movement is weak, because each labor union has been forced to, they might say, or has taken the road of representing only those who pay it dues and not expanding, and not even those, in some cases, our colleague said in the front row, well, that's, I hope, what we'll talk about. That's true. Sometimes not even those, and yet not looking beyond to think of representing workers or the working class. Yet, I would say, even within that very constricted and very weakened I won't call it a movement, but set of organizations in labor, there still are possibilities. For one, there are the possibilities of internal transformation, which is something I've been very humbled to see as a leader of a labor union. I'm thinking of somebody who wrote recently, who's a part-time faculty member and adjunct at City University of New York, one of our 12,000 adjuncts. Shame on City University. But one of them who said the first demonstration she had been to in her life was a demonstration that our union put together, and it was about health insurance for part-time faculty. And she said she had never been so moved as she was when she saw that full-time faculty were the majority of the demonstrators at that event. And some of you were there. That she stepped right in from the outside into that demonstration and became an activist with the union. Or I think of the person who worked in our union on health issues and safety of the buildings. And she gave a presentation, she put up a slide of how the a broken staircase had been fixed after they got together and worked as a group. And she put up the slide and she said, well, when somebody asks me what a union is, I look at that slide and that's a union. And she started to cry. So you can't, and I'll start to cry if I talk about it much longer, but you can't underestimate the internal transformations that also come from doing that work that stretches people, that pushes them toward toward change, toward everyday revolutions. So I want to keep in mind that possibility, and also think about a few of the things that we have tried to do as a union, where we've tried to enter that arena of making change that goes beyond simply bargaining with the boss or simply getting something for our members. All of us, and there's some of the people here with whom I entered this union when we took over power from an existing leadership, we did it because we wanted to imagine, and not only imagine, but realize what a union might be able to do if it thought about itself differently, even within these conditions, even within labor as it stands now and the direct confrontation with power. We tried to, and we continue to try, to take on things that might not be seen as traditional labor issues. We were the forefront of the coalition that fought to get undocumented students in New York State access to in-state tuition and at the state universities. And now we're also working on, I see Michael Feinberg, whom I've been proud to stand with at several demonstrations on the issue. Now we're trying to get those same students access to financial aid. We're working against the grain in some cases there, but that's one of the areas we've worked on. We were the first union to go out and welcome Occupy. They lived right down the street from us. They used our bathroom and quite a few other things, came in every night. We saw that as vital for our union. We learned from them. We tried to support them. I don't think we deserve to applaud them. Applaud for them for what we learned from them. But that was the kind of connection, continues to be the kind of connection that goes from that everything to just doing a film series that we do once a month where we've tried to reimagine what it might be like to go to the movies in our perfect world. What would it be like? It would cost nothing or be free. You'd serve wine and cheese. You'd have a lecture about the movie by somebody who was a scholar in that area. And you might stop the film, as they did in the Argentinian Third Cinema. Stop it sometimes and get the audience to start talking about the film halfway through. How would they end this film before you turn us back into just being a passive audience? So we've tried, from things large to small, to imagine differently what a labor union might be doing differently. And still we find, and this is where I think it's so important to have heard our last two speakers, still we find how difficult it is within a system that has not been not only revolutionized, but even reformed. So listening to Rick and listening to Rob's very important point about internationalism, I'd like to try to put together a couple of the things that they said. I think, yes, the idea of a national left movement would be a very important and powerful idea. But I think we also, when we do that, we have to think about international movements. And I'd like to ask Rick, and I hope somebody does in the question period, when he said that such a movement or such an organization would confront capitalism. I'd like to push us a little further. What would it mean to confront capitalism? What would we do once we had made that confrontation? Because as somebody who confronts it all the time, I'd like to hear what we really mean by just confronting and then what's the next step after that. And I'd like to think about why our struggles are so varied in the way that you described so perfectly. Why they're so varied, why some of us are fighting tooth and nail about racism or feminism or gay liberation or any of the powerful things we fight about, environmentalism, what about that? And I think it's because capitalism is so everywhere. It's so total. It's in all of those things that you mentioned. It's all of those. So I'd like to put those together. And finally, I guess, I think about, as a union person, I'd like to think about how unions should be those organizations. We have a possibility. Labor could be that movement. If anything could confront capital, it could be unions that do that. What would that mean? What would that look like? And especially an educational union. What would that mean to, what power do we have in that position as unions that come face to face with both the issues of capital and education? So Rick tells us, Rob told us earlier about people born into oppression who just get up and rise up. And I think that's a first step, and certainly as somebody who speaks from within an organization that has tried to get up and rise up and continues to try to get up and rise up every single day to reimagine everything we're doing, but constantly feels those limits, I think this is something that maybe a lot of you understand and have experienced from your own lives. How do we take that to the next step? How do we bring that experience, which is a powerful experience? I don't want to leave that experience behind because I think it's been a very powerful experience to have that struggle every day and try to reimagine our whole world, really, from that perspective already within a confined struggle. How do we bring that into a more liberatory, airy, national, as you said, Rick, or maybe international conversation and movement? So I look forward, most of all, to hearing from Amy tonight, whom I'm very, who always does a beautiful job with helping us to say what we really wish to say, and also from all of you. We have a chance here tonight with almost 5,000 people coming to something that says left and something that says forum. Let's not forget that. Let's make this a forum where we can talk and listen to each other about our desire, our hope, and our plan to build. So let's start building. Let's build the big organization, but I would also say to you, build it where you are too. Don't wait till we have that organization. Start building right now, because the experience of building in your workplace, your home, your factory, your school is an invaluable experience that cannot be replicated. And that's the experience we must build on when we take on the powerful work of building together. So thank you all very much for being here. I look forward to it. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. Okay, so we have about an hour. I see people are handing in their index cards. If you have a question or comment, put it over there in the straw basket. And we'll be putting those questions to our panelists. But why don't we start with Barbara's question to Rick, and that is how you most effectively confront capitalism. You can say that.
Well, you know, one of the first things we need to do, unified or not, is to face up to our own weaknesses on the left, not the least of which is that we have a variety of different notions of what capitalism and confronting it mean. That's not a problem, but it's a problem if you don't face the fact that you have different notions that imply a different meaning to what confronting capitalism might mean. So let me explain. Traditionally, when leftists have used phrases like confronting capitalism, they've meant something like this: that in the place of private enterprises, privately controlled, we ought to have state enterprises run for the benefit of the society as a whole and managed by the government. Traditional socialists meant that more than they meant anything else. Another idea of confronting capitalism was to distribute goods and services and resources, not by means of market exchange, where things go to the people with the most money to throw into the deal, but rather by something called government planning, or social planning, or central planning. In other words, to confront capitalism was to go from the private to the public, and from the market to the plan. Certainly was the idea of the Soviet Union, the idea of the People's Republic of China, and of many of those experiments of the last century. I don't mean that. It's not what I understand confronting capitalism to mean. I'm going to exaggerate this point, but I want to get the idea across. For me, confronting capitalism, and this would be what I would urge, and as in fact I have done, urged on labor unions as a strategic decision, means to confront the following. We as people in modern capitalist societies, we depend for our lives every day on food, clothing, shelter, and 1,000 other objects without which we can't live, we can't survive. And we organize the production of these things we depend on in a particular way. It's called the corporation. And the corporation is an institution in which a tiny number of people make all the key decisions. The major shareholders, in most corporations that's 10 or 20 people. And the board of directors, selected by those major shareholders, that's another 15 to 20 people. They decide what will be produced, how it will be produced, where it will be produced, and what will be done with the profits of that enterprise. The vast majority of the people, the overwhelming majority of the people who work in any enterprise have to live with the results of what's produced, how is it produced, and where it's produced, and how the profits are sold. But they have no participation in making any of those decisions. The modern corporation is a fundamentally anti-democratic institution. And if you're going to have capitalism organized in that way, which we do, then the claim that we live in a democratic society is empty, is false. We live in a society that does not, a society that does not permit democratically organized production. And where do most adults spend most of their lives? 5 out of 7 days, all the best hours of the day, at work. A democratic society would implant democracy first in the place where most people spend their lives, in the workplace. We live in a society that exempts the workplace from ever conforming to democratic values or norms. So for me, what we need to do is to confront enterprises, confront capitalism where it lives, where it's grounded, in the production system of our enterprises, and to say boldly, we want democracy at work. We want organizations of production to be organized as cooperatives, democratically run by all the people involved, not by a handful of shareholders and boards of directors. And why? Make it really brief. If we want the economic system to serve the people, then the people have to be in charge of the economic system. Otherwise, you get what we have, which is an economic system organized and run by shareholders and boards of directors, and then the New York Times is shocked to discover that the bulk of the money raised by these organizations goes to the dividend recipients, the shareholders, and the top executives who sit on the board of directors. The inequality of our society that we claim to be concerned about is an immediate fruit of how the tiny minority that runs our enterprises divides the wealth that's produced there. It isn't distributed among all who help to produce it. Your job in the workplace is to produce it. They take it, they distribute it, you live with the results. Imagine a labor movement doing exactly what Barbara said, and said so eloquently, going beyond the notion of serving just the folks who pay the dues, but being the vanguard, if I can dare to use the term, of a social movement that said, no, 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 we want to change the whole way enterprises are organized, whether there's a union there or not. We want to substitute a new and different way of organizing economics that is not capitalist, that is democratic and cooperative. And as Barbara, I'm sure, will remind us, the labor movement has begun to do exactly that. The Steelworkers Union has a deal with the Mondragon Cooperative Corporation, the biggest co-op in the world. And I think that confronting capitalism in this way would be a dramatic way for the labor movement to recapture the leading role it once had on the left, and which I wish, as I think so many of us would, it would do again. But there's a way to do it, to show that you are in favor of a social change that could galvanize and attract masses of people, both to that goal and to the labor movement, as once again a leading force for social change.
Rob, you want to address that issue?
Yeah, I just want to touch a little bit. I would think at one point maybe labor unions, and I'm no labor union expert, were leaning in that direction or moving in that direction. You heard me talk about General Baker last night, the organizing auto workers in Detroit. And I think at one point they were going in that direction, but I think the capitalist forces saw what was happening and crushed that movement, right? It really suppressed it. Started pushing automobile production outside of the US, subsequently just pushing down that movement and making it disappear. So I think at one time they were. I think here, and Barbara can correct me if I'm wrong, I'm no union expert, but I think there are a couple of unions here within New York that are thinking in that direction. Probably the Transit Workers Union, you know, it's a pretty radical union working with community organizations. And I also think 32BJ, the Commercial Food Workers Union, are pushing the envelope a little bit and moving in that direction.
How do you assess the Occupy movement today and the effects that it has had? And all of your work, and overall, where you think it could lead. any one of you who wants
well,
to.
Well, I'll start off. I just came out of a similar panel talking about this. I think one great thing that came out of Occupy was taking our economic struggles and putting them under one umbrella. I think we were moving towards a little bit of that political education that I talked about, right? As you understand that 1% of this country has 40%, most of the wealth in this country, it starts to make you understand that there is an issue and there are forces that you're challenged by. So I think the actual language that they gave us, 1%, 99%, was huge, right? That was something that we didn't understand, and it just poured it into the mainstream dialogue, right? We had to understand that these are the issues. I think also the young folks at CUNY, I think Free University is really pushing this issue. They're part of the Occupy movement. So I think the more we have these types of conversations, we're moving in towards that political education that I think is necessary. But how do you package this so that it gets out to the masses, right? These are little pockets of folks that are getting educated, and we need to move it out to the masses. So I think that's the challenges that people on the ground have to figure out and have to work through.
I add just a couple of things to that.
Barbara.
Yeah, I think what Rob said is very important in terms of just the language, how many times we've heard the language of the 99% and the 1%, all the chants, we are the 99%. I mean, that is still a good chant. And I think one of the things we saw there was the alliance, the idea at least, that the middle class, as you know, the great American identification with the middle class might be joined with an identification with the working class and the poor, instead of always identifying aspirationally to be the ruling class. So joining the middle class to the working class was an important thing that happened with that 1%, at least conceptually. I'm not saying that it created that joining overnight, and I think the occupiers themselves knew that. Another thing that we might think about, especially since Rick asked us to think so provocatively and importantly about a national organization, Occupy tried a different formation, right? That was part of what Occupy was about, at least as I understand it, was to say that the forms that we've used to organize ourselves are part of the problem. And if we want to do a broader movement that is actually not only going to confront capitalism, but do something about undoing capitalism, that such a movement would need not to repeat the forms of capitalism, and that we'd have to discover new forms in which to organize ourselves. Not every one of the forms they tried worked. I mean, how many of us here have been at General Assemblies at Occupy? Okay, so we know that there were virtues to that, which we still learned, but not everything worked there. But that was one of the things I think that was very important about that was trying to find a new form, something we also learned from the feminist movement. One of the things that feminism taught us was that the forms that existed could also be forms that oppressed us. The master's tools will not unmake the master's house, right? And that model from Occupy, I think, was also important. And then on another level, which is much more electoral, Occupy made it possible, if not imperative, if not even fashionable, to talk about inequality. We suddenly have mainstream politicians being elected under the banner of fighting inequality and gathering the support of people from many different places in the political spectrum under that idea. You know, of course that's not instantly going to undo inequality, but the idea that more than those who are, you know, who are most oppressed have a stake in undoing and fighting inequality, I think is a very important idea. So it's up to us to keep that idea from being diminished and domesticated, and keep some of the edge on that idea. I'm sure the occupiers are thinking of their next move, and also thinking of that important idea that you can claim a space and claim an area under the banner of Occupy. And I look forward to what they do next, because I think they're going to continue to push us, all of us.
Can I add a level of criticism, not particularly to Barbara, but to the Occupy movement? I think one critical misstep they did while they were moving in the right directions and trying not to replicate forces, but in some ways they did, I was very critical of the lack of opening up spaces to have those critical dialogues about race, class, sexism, gender, and all of that stuff. That didn't happen. And that's why you had these formations like Occupy the Hood. It became problematic, right? And I mean, even to name yourself Occupy the hood is already occupied, right? That's part of the problem. So creating spaces, right, to have those important dialogues and bring in the people that are directly affected, I think was a critique of mine to the Occupy movement. I don't know how folks feel in general, but it was definitely a critique of mine.
Rick, do you want to weigh in?
Yeah, the only thing I would add that hasn't already been said well by the other two speakers is a historical note. Once the Cold War got underway after World War II, the American left was shown by the Smith Act trials, by the anti-communist witch hunts, McCarthyism, all of that, that either you shut up if you're on the left, or if you do anything, you got to be damn sure it doesn't look, smell, taste, or have any reference to something that could look, sound, or smell like anti-capitalism. That was a taboo. And so if you were active against racial inequality or sexism or whatever it was, you immediately got caught up sooner or later in the organizations between those who wanted to broaden the issue and look at the system of economics too, and those who said don't do that because then the wrath of the police and everything else will come down on you. And that was a very important part, and why so little of the broader economics was brought in by all of those other movements, thereby contributing to that fracturing that I talked about before. For me, one of the most dramatic moments was exactly what Barbara pointed to. This, not only did the Occupy not shy away from the economic issues, it put them front and center. It made them the 1%, 99%, the emblem of what we're about. That changed everything in that dramatic way that language has, where suddenly not just words and phrases were possible that weren't before, but ways of thinking became normalized and routinized. And that opens the space for us dramatically, and has been doing it ever since.
As we continue this discussion, I'll weave some of the questions in of people. One person asked, how can we maximize the benefits of the good faith of the de Blasio's Bill and Shirley despite not getting the changes we want? What is your assessment of Bill de Blasio's victory? Do you see it as a victory of the left? What is your assessment? What matters most is of his administration so far?
Rob has been the most outspoken about this issue. So I think, again, we bought into a dream. He ran on a platform of a tale of two cities. And he created a lot of talk and created a lot of interest in his campaign, and he won election. And the very first appointment he did was appoint Bill Bratton, Giuliani's police chief, who created the broken windows theory of policing. And for me, I saw no reaction from the grassroots community, absolutely none, when I thought there should have been outrage. And then he said, you know what, they didn't get up, they didn't react. And then he chose Alicia Glenn to run his housing program, right? And she came from Goldman Sachs after all we've been through, right? So it's same old Democratic politics that's been going on, right? They can send all the messages out that they want. I'll give him a little bit of time, right? He's just been elected to office. I don't think too much is going to change. I think what needs to change is we need to rise up and speak out. Risk, right? But if you don't take risk, you don't get social change, right? Social change comes about because of risk, right? We got the Civil Rights Act because people took it to the streets. People refused to no longer go in separate bathrooms. People refused to no longer sit in the back of the bus. They took a risk, right? You know, and it comes about as these social clashes that we go through in history. So maybe we're at a point of a social clash, I don't know. But I just, you know, when it comes to de Blasio, I'm not optimistic. I'm going to wait and see. I want to give him a little bit of time, but I think the first two appointments he made was a telltale sign. And I'm, you know.
But do you see a space that wasn't there before?
I guess.
Is it so much about what he does and who he chooses, or whether you think there's room to maneuver and move?
Well, I think he made attempts, right? And he made it look that way, right? He invited everybody to the tents in Tribeca, and they were going to have big, deep discussions, right? And he gathered all of this information, and it was his transition team. And I'm like, how do I know that that information is going to go to the right place? How do I know that that's going to result in change? And they couldn't give you the real answers. What I saw was, right after talking transition, I saw Bill Bratton get elected, or get put into office, right? He pushes Bill Bratton out there. So I'm not, I guess, I think different spaces have been created. He has an ambitious housing program, but it's only making Bloomberg's program bigger, right? So as you create affordable housing the same way Bloomberg did, you just create more 80-20 housing. 80% going market rate, 20% for poor folks who need it, but it doesn't necessarily work for the communities that need it. So it's still a problematic policy. You're replicating past policies that didn't work, making them bigger and giving the appearance, because the number is what we feed in on.
Do you think candidates like de Blasio, and then politicians, elected officials like de Blasio and President Obama, provide a space or demobilize movements?
Demobilize.
In the end, they demobilize. They make it, they give the appearance that they're creating spaces, right? They give people a false sense of hope, right? I'll be honest, I was on the mall for WBAI the day that he got put into office, right? He was sworn into office, freezing cold day. You know, everybody remembers that. You see everybody hugging and people coming from all over the country to be on the mall. There was a false sense of hope. People had hope. It was realistic. It made it seem real. The color, the face of the president changed. The color changed, right? But it's the same old Democratic politics. In the end, he was put out there as a puppet to keep the same policies going. We bought into the color of the face changing. The first black man ever elected to president is a huge moment in this country. It really was. Whether he is not righteous with his policies or not, it was a huge moment in this country, right? To say that an African American got elected by the popular vote, but in the end, he came from the same old Democratic Party, and somebody else is pushing the policy forward.
I also was on the mall that day, or right before, actually. It was freezing cold, and what I remember, though, which was so interesting, and I also had that criticism of the president before he took office, I have to say that the symbolic value of that, and more than the symbolic, the emotional and the historical value of that moment, permeated Washington in a way that just, at least for me, gave a glimpse in the city for a couple of days, just the way people were with each other on the street and the feeling, however, based on misimpression or false hope or whatever else, I think what was inside people, what I felt, was a little bit of what a world would be like without racism. There was a feeling among people that I have experienced only in movements and that time in general on the street. That's the only other time I had felt that. And it was a little possibility of what a relief it would be to be in a world without racism. And I felt the longing for that on that day, which was something very powerful that we have to keep and mobilize. So to go back to Amy's question, does the election of someone who runs on an explicitly progressive platform create or diminish possibilities for movement, create or rechannel those possibilities? I really think that's up to us, not up to that person in office. I mean, I totally understand the power structures that put people there. We are a union that made a democratic decision in our union to endorse Bill de Blasio, and our members worked hard for de Blasio because of his platform of fighting inequality and naming that from the start, and also the fact that he named education as an important priority for investment, and particularly this university. And those of you who haven't been to CUNY before, you're getting a somewhat skewed view of what our buildings look like, just by the way. They don't all look like this, believe me. If you've been to the Bronx, if you've been to some of our other campuses, they don't look like this, and they need serious investment. And that raised a lot of hope and possibility for us. So we're a union that's still working with de Blasio, and I don't think, as you know, as you were suggesting, Amy, I don't think it's just about the appointments. It's about what pressure will arise, what force can be, what doors are possibly open because of that explicit announcement, what expectations were raised, and now that we must work for and as hard as we can. And unions, I think, this picks up on what Rick said earlier, unions have to realize that our work cannot be simply to choose the right person and get that person in office and use all of our members' resources to support that person. Too much of unions' national action, actually, you know, billions of dollars nationally goes into doing that work. If at least an equal amount of money were put into organizing in our own workplaces, we would have an entirely different
I'm not dissenting from what was said before, but I'm looking at it a little bit different. Of course, there is hope that an Obama or de Blasio means something. And I think it did mean something. It meant that there was a lot more support for this thing than most people, black or white, thought there was. Those black folks that I know were as surprised by Obama's victory, maybe more so, than most of the white people I knew. They didn't expect it. And I think the de Blasio thing coming out of nowhere was in large part a reaction of the people of New York against Bloomberg, against Bloomberg's candidate, which was, if you remember her, Christine Quinn. There was something going on there that changed the mood in the political world and what people were willing to vote for. So now we have de Blasio, and he has all the problems that, that Bob and Barbara have talked about. But here's where we come in. What a fantastic moment to teach a political lesson to people who are ready to learn it. What does it mean that we voted for X and he can't do what it is we thought he meant, he said he might or tried to do? Let's take him at his word, he's trying. He's not able. He felt he had to get Mr. Bratt. What does that tell us? What is the political lesson we draw from what in fact is happening here? To coin a famous political leader, you can make a bad thing into a good thing if you interpret what that bad thing is and why it's happening. Lessons will be drawn that will then move in a direction so you don't have this bad thing in the future. And one of the things that may come from this is, as Barbara was suggesting, the notion, and as Rob did too, that we rely on our own forces. We don't second guess what politicians in other areas might or might not be able to do. We build our own, and we elect our own, and we know what they're going to do, because that's the basis on which we put them forward.
So, just one quick thing. I just wanted to say, Margaret Prescott just gave me this information that Yuri Kochiyama has died. Yuri Kochiyama is a remarkable woman, Japanese-American, who was interned with her family in the Japanese internment camps and went on to be an activist not only in the Asian-American community, but very close to Malcolm X. She cradled his head when he was killed February 21st, 1965. Fought for political prisoners, was very active in the case of Mumia Abu-Jamal. She lived in Harlem for a very long time and then moved to California, where she was born. I interviewed her at her assisted living home, and it's very sad news, but her life embodied the movements of the 20th century. Truly amazing woman.
Thank you. I just
wanted to respond. Again, I agree with Rick, but I guess I'm pessimistic with respect to the grassroots community and their responses, right? So where does that, where do those conversations happen, Rick? That's where I'm troubled. As I get into communities, folks aren't having those conversations and aren't creating those spaces. That's what I mean with political education. Where is that analysis being done? I think where it can be done, classrooms like yours, like David's, and some of these other progressive academia, coming together and thinking about that, right? You have to bring the grassroots community and academia together to drop these theories. However, there has been a reluctance of the grassroots community and with some valid reasons that we can't come into the classroom because all they do is spew theory. It has to be a way for either grassroots communities to bring academia into the community. I think it has to be reciprocal, right? It has to work both ways. So a conference like this, parts of this, and Rick and I have talked about this and the rest of the board, how do you bring something smaller like this into the community so those conversations happen? Where are those spaces? And thinking forward like that, because they need to happen.
We have many, many questions. Among them, how do you link the danger of climate catastrophe to the need to abolish capitalism?
One implies the other. Look, the long history of struggles against capitalism, and since this is what I teach and what I study, let me just summarize for you. Capitalism, like every other system, has had its critics from the day it was born. It is not a system that has overcome criticism. If anything, it is a system that has widened and deepened criticism. That criticism always began in all the histories of capitalism, wherever it settled, with people who were horrified or frightened or threatened by its consequences. All that this climate concern is the recognition that there are yet more consequences to be horrified, frightened, and threatened by than we had understood. Was it just the inequality? It wasn't just the lack of medical care or education or all the other consequences. You know, someone made reference before to the, you know, all of us did, to the 1%, 99%. The United Nations recently issued a report that indicated that not only do we have more wealth in the hands of the top 1% of the United States, but globally the same process is going on, whether it's in China or India or Brazil or the inequality is becoming so extreme that you have to go back to ancient Egypt and pharaohs and pyramids to get things even looking remotely like what we are now learning to make as normal. That's horrific in all of its social consequences. Climate change is yet another example of the irrationality of a drive to accumulate capital, to compete one with the other, where nobody in a position of authority has the time or the place to consider the environmental consequences because they're struggling to survive in a system that requires that way of decision making. The danger is that, like all of the other problems, it will be explained as the fault of something other than the economic system. So we don't mess with the economic system. We instead decide, my apologies for those who may be offended, that the really important thing is to separate our garbage into three different piles, which is a fantastic way of not dealing with what the cause of this problem is.
There are people working on that right now, and there's an active movement right now to go with the summit on climate change at the UN in September, right, John Hyam, where are you? September what?
20th and 21st.
That does offer a powerful possibility for bringing that together. I would just say one more thing to what Rick said, which is the catastrophe with the environment isn't, and I know you didn't mean it this way, but just isn't just yet another consequence. It may be the last consequence if we don't solve it. And it is the most natural alliance, I think, labor and environmentalism. It's tragic that they've been so far apart, despite the blue-green alliance and the turtles in Seattle and everything. So there is a possibility for that this September, and people who are thinking of organizing might start thinking of bringing some of that organizing and what we learned from Occupy to that moment. That's only one moment, that doesn't change everything, but I think that it is, it's got to be, it's such a powerful and natural alliance that should be taking place, working people and people trying to save the place so that we can continue to live and work. So I would urge, I think that's exactly what we should be doing, and we have an opportunity this September.
Another person asked, how is the military best converted to democracy? Any modern historical examples?
Egypt.
And what about overall the issue of war?
I think the amount of money going to the military is just totally ridiculous, and how do we move? And I think this goes back to the issue of elected officials. We know that's a problem, but where's the outreach? Where are we picking up and challenging those people that we put in office to make the decision, to change those decisions? It was once told to me that the two biggest air forces in the world are the U.S. Air Force and the U.S. Navy. That's ridiculous. It is totally ridiculous. So why do we need to spend all of that money to defend the country? To defend what? The Pacific Rim. China has the Pacific Rim. It's theirs, right? You can't do anything about it. That's what you're challenging. So what's the reason for putting those types of resources into that? And I think it's just the imperial nature of this country has always been that way, to colonize other territories, and that continues until we rise up. But again, we're afraid of revolutions. It's a dirty term.
Maybe just add that just this week, our union passed a resolution opposing the reintroduction of ROTC at CUNY. About 2011, the American Enterprise Institute came out with a report describing how New York and City University of New York in particular was an underserved resource and an untapped resource for the military, because here were all these students, largely students of color, who could be recruited to be in the military. And it's not a simple issue because of the free or supported tuition, I should say free, but supported tuition, the various enticements that our students receive to join ROTC. But I will say that it was introduced at four campuses, at Medgar Evers College in Brooklyn, which is actually considered a historically black college, our highest percentage of African American students. The faculty there got together and voted to remove ROTC from the campus. We listened to what the faculty voted. Rudy Cruz, the president there, and he has to abide by that. And also at the College of Staten Island, the faculty have moved to prevent ROTC from doing that. So that's one little comment. It's not the whole story, but since that's an issue right now about militarization of academic institutions, it might be worth keeping in mind.
Do you think there's a way of reconceptualizing the left that would include other people who might not call themselves left? That perhaps conservative and liberal lines are breaking down, that people concerned about corporate control and global surveillance, climate change, increasing disparity between rich and poor might actually cross the political spectrum? Rick Wall.
Yes, and let me give you a response that draws on the European experience, because I think there are big lessons to be learned there. There are several countries that work this way, but I'm going to take the example of Greece. And the reason I choose Greece is because it has been probably the worst impacted so far by the economic crisis and by the austerity programs of governments like our own that claim to deal with this. So Greece has an unemployment problem, unemployment rate now in the high 20s, 25% to 30%. Its economy has contracted 20-25% since the crisis hit in 2007, and on and on and on. Very, very extreme a set of circumstances. Now, what happened in that situation was a clear demonstration to the Greek people that an economic crisis no one had told them was coming came. An economic crisis that they had been told by all the economics experts, even if it did come, wouldn't last very long, is still going on. It cut terribly deep, it lasted terribly long. Then the government stepped in with an array of policies which made it worse. I don't know if you're aware of it, but the debt of the Greek government as a percentage of its GNP, which was in the neighborhood of 130% when the crisis began, is now in the neighborhood of 175%. 6 years of austerity program have made the problem worse. Okay? In that moment, this is the answer to Amy's question, your question. In that moment, something transformed Greek politics, and it happened overnight. It happened in between the last months of 2011 and the first the 6 months into June, roughly, 2012. Here's what happened. The two traditional parties, in the Greek words, Tweedledum and Tweedledee, that's a joke. They're equivalent of the Democrats and the Republicans. Greece being what it is, that's called the conservatives and the socialists. But believe me, Democrat and Republican, it's close enough, okay? Those two parties, like here, had together captured 70-80% of the vote year after year after year. The Greek people turned away from them and never came back. We're now in 2 years beyond that time. In the last parliamentary elections, 10 days ago, those two parties got 28% of the vote. And what happened was a leftist party, Syriza, some of you know the name, which is Greek for a group of far-left political parties, which was the most uncompromising, anti-austerity, anti-socialist, because the socialists, they claim, had sold them out. That party, in the last election 10 days ago, came in number one. Which means that it is possible, if they succeed in forcing new elections in Greece, that's an open question, the way their parliamentary system works. But if they get new elections, and if the Syriza comes in number one, we're going to have a whole new political situation in all of Europe, because you'll have a government of a European country, one of whose slogans is, Greece can do better than capitalism. Wow. It happened very fast. It wasn't predicted. It wasn't foreseen. Question. Why would anyone need to believe that what happened in Greece couldn't happen here too? The irony would be, Greece has a long history of leftist organization. We haven't had that for a long time. So we might be in the bizarre situation of a possible breakthrough without our organizational means to make it happen.
Right now.
Someone asked, why has there been almost no discussion about campaign reform, money in politics, getting rid of the Electoral College, a way to get rid of the lobbies and the corporate money behind them?
I'll just say, I'm not in favor of electoral politics, so we can move on from that. I think communities need to make decisions and govern themselves. Right? And what that looks like, I'm not sure of, but I think that's the better way. Electoral politics hasn't worked for me since I was alive. So we need to think of something different. What that is, I don't know. But again, those are those political conversations we need to have, and they're just not happening.
Rick and Barbara, do you think who is in office matters?
Well, sure, it matters.
No, go ahead.
Yes, it matters because of all the things we've been talking about. Spaces are created, movements are strengthened and weakened, lessons are learned and not. It makes a great deal of difference, not only who's in office, but how we as a left understand and interpret what it means, what's happening, why they do what they do. Because that's how all people react to whatever the political landscape shapes us, and given the attention given to our political landscape by our mass media, it would be crazy not to be involved, engaged, and have something to say that hopefully people will find interesting and persuasive about what's going on. And while I understand what Rob is saying, and I share a good bit of it, I do still think that there might be all kinds of mileage that we could gain in the way of building the left if we did take some principled positions about how elections work. Let me just give you one example. In all European countries, there is a system called proportional representation. It's a simple idea which says that whatever the percentage is that you get of the popular vote as a political party, you get that percentage of the seats in the legislature or the parliament. And the idea is, this may come as a shock, that anything that calls itself democratic would have to work that way, because there's no reason to say that if 13% of the people believe X, they shouldn't have 13% of the people making the laws, since it's 13% who want that. So it's a crazy idea. And we here in the United States are absolutely schizophrenic on this subject, which makes it possible for us to make political gain around it. We have, for example, presidential primaries that work on a proportional representation. You know, in the race between Obama and Clinton, in many states, if one of them got 42% of the vote, the other one got 58%, then that's the number of delegates they got. In other words, you gave them the proportion where it counted based on the vote they got. For those of you that remember your New York history, you go back to the many years ago, and this was the city, I believe the first one in the United States, that elected to the city council an African-American member of the Communist Party, Benjamin Davis. If you actually look at that election, the reason he got elected was that we had proportional representation here in New York City for several years. By the way, it was killed off because he won that election and sat on the seat. But the point is, that's an argument we could take to the American people, and for which there would be a great deal of sympathy if there were a movement pushing it, not as the be-all and end-all, and not even as an argument against having a great skeptical distance about electoral politics, but for those for whom that's an important issue, this is a position we could win on.
I'll just be very quick, because I'd like to get us to the next couple of questions and have some more time to hear. And when I, you know, when I answer this partly, I'm answering as the head of a public sector labor union that works directly with who's in office. And I have the elected responsibility of representing the people in my union, not just my own view. So I think it matters. And I agree with Rick that there should be much more discussion and discussion from the left. The left could have some very important and interesting things to say that go beyond just like putting our person in office. So I'll leave it at that because I'd like to make room for other questions.
And there are many. Basic question, when left people say socialism, what does it specifically mean? Big government, a new kind of New Deal policy, socialist nation?
I don't want to repeat what I said before, so very briefly. Some people mean socialism that the government takes an enormous role. I don't understand that. I don't find that in Karl Marx, and I spent a lot of time reading that. Other people think it's all about how you distribute goods and services by planning rather than by markets. I don't understand that either. That is, I understand that there is a difference between these two ways of distributing goods, just like there's a difference between a bigger and a smaller role of the government. But I don't think that gets to the fundamental question of how you organize the production and distribution of goods. We organize it in a capitalist corporate way. For me, socialism is the fundamental alternative way of organizing production. Let me give you one implication of this. We spend a great deal of time in our society fighting with one another about redistributing income. Right? We recognize that some people are awfully poor, while a lot of other people are awfully rich. And we're troubled by that. We're even more troubled by the thought that the people who don't have much might be troubled by that, and where that might lead. So we invent schemes, progressive taxes, subsidies, social programs, whose job it is to kind of take a little bit from those who have a lot and distribute it to those who don't. These things cause us tremendous anxiety. Those who have are enraged that it's being taken from them. They'd like to believe they deserve what they got. They don't want to be taxed. So we have tremendous fights amongst ourselves. We develop very expensive bureaucracies to manage the movement of the... What are we doing? The problem with our inequality isn't going to be solved effectively by redistributing. The solution is, don't distribute it unequally in the first place. Then you won't have to have the costly, socially divisive, often violently, politically agitating struggles over redistribution. And how would you do it? By transforming the capitalist corporation. It's only because a tiny group of people run the businesses, own the wealth, 1% of shareholders own 75% of the shares. It's only because we have that we have the unequal distribution that then plunges us into these conflicts about redistribution. For me, socialism is the transformation of the organization of production so that these kinds of problems aren't solved in a new way. They don't exist anymore.
Why don't we end, actually where you began, talking about your own, each of your own awareness, how you came to get involved politically. And I think that especially touches young people, but for everyone. Rick, you talked about how you ended up being an economist, but how you became an economist, but how did you get politically involved?
Well, not to bore you with biographical detail, both my parents were immigrants to the United States. I'm the first part of my family born here in the United States, and I was born, which carries some meaning, in a place called Youngstown, Ohio. My father was French and my mother German. I didn't speak English until I was 6, hence the heavy German accent you can detect in my speech. I grew up with an immigrant family that had absolutely no money ever for anything. So I grew up pretty poor, but it was bizarre because it was poor, but my parents were both university graduates. The poverty was the peculiar immigration story, not the story of generations of poverty. So I went to high school, and I had to do what often immigrant children had to do. I had to make up to my parents the life that immigration had cut off for them. They couldn't make it in their native country, they couldn't finish the university, they couldn't keep a career. I had to do that for them. I had to make it up to them what life had blocked from them. I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. The psychological pressure is enormous. But it forces you, I mean, either to collapse psychologically, and I knew plenty of people, that's what happened to them. I was lucky that didn't happen to me. I got the megalomaniac idea that I could do everything my mother and father assigned me to do. So here is a kid, grows up with no money and has really very little going for him. And then I end up, because I work like a crazy person, and I go to Harvard as an undergraduate. When I finish, I go to Stanford to get my master's degree, and then I finished up at Yale to get my PhD degree. So look at me. I'm like a poster boy for elite education. But here's what it did to this biography. I was confronted with the absurdity of the wealth of those institutions juxtaposed over and against everything I had known up until that moment. And I was frankly traumatized by what I saw and what I experienced. And I think in those early years as an undergraduate at Harvard, where I learned what a tweed jacket meant, why it was important to have a pipe in your mouth, why it was important to know the name of important authors of important works, even if you didn't have a clue to what was in there, and how to speak about it as if you had read the book. I learned important skills that have served me very well. Every time my leftism has been a problem, which, if you're an academic, happens often enough, I learned that if I waved my pedigree, people would back off like, you know, Dracula, garlic, and all the rest. And I would be allowed to say and do things that other people weren't allowed to do. Since the education I got in these institutions was stunningly mediocre, I nonetheless remain grateful to them for having allowed me to be a Marxist economist in American universities all my adult life. Sense of satisfaction that the learning I did acquire, not so much because of these institutions, but thankfully despite them, has been able to be turned in a direction none of them would have wished.
Rob Robinson.
That's hard to follow. I'm going to be honest. Rick, I've known Rick probably about 3 years now, 4 years. A lot of Professor Stanley, who was here before, I spent time in his classes, obviously have a relationship with David. So you can bet I'll be invading classes at the New School this coming semester, right? You know, just to sit in and be a fly on the wall. It's going to be pretty cool. But for me personally, it was personal transformation. I was born here in New York City and raised on Long Island in a working class family, but
where?
In Freeport, Long Island, on the South Shore of Nassau County. Graduated from the University of Maryland. That's where I injured my leg. I went to school on a college scholarship at the University of Maryland. And I was able, even with my parents, much like Rick's not having that education, my dad was smart enough to say, well, he's had a history of leg injury, so if you're going to take him into the school, you know, you're gonna have to guarantee that he gets a 4-year education. So one thing I got out of playing football, even being injured, or the ability to play football, was a college education. I was the first one in my family to graduate high school, to graduate college. So it was huge within my family. Eventually through my working career, so I worked for ADP, as you read, WISE at a Fortune 500 company. That company was automatic data processing. Worked my way up from a teleservice rep to being in charge of installing a piece of software that automatic data processing ADP said would take it into the new millennium. It was a call center software, and out of the 60,000 employees they had worldwide, I probably understood and knew how to work that software the best. I'd worked with the developers to develop it into ADP's type software with ADP language, etc. And I became a project manager overseeing the installation of that software in ADP's 4 core businesses around the world. I was asked to move from Long Island to Miami, Florida in March 2001, which I was kind of stunned. Out of 60,000 employees, you picked this African-American male, you know, there's a lot of other people. Didn't have a degree in technology. I went to school and got a degree in restaurant hotel technology, right? So I didn't have an IT degree, but I just, you know, I had an interest in this stuff and I just learned from the people that were within ADP. March 2001, I pick up my life, moved to Miami, Florida, and started a new position, overseeing the installation. We were beta testing it in a new division of ADP called ADP TotalSource. In July 2001, I was called into the general manager's office and told, we no longer have a position for you at this company. So after living my entire life in New York and working 13 years for this company, I picked up on a 1 month's notice, moved to Miami, and I suddenly found myself unemployed. I said, well, you know what? I'm a confident guy. I'll find work in Miami. Decided to pick up my life and move to Miami. I looked and constantly looked around and couldn't find work. So after a year, severance pay ran out, unemployment pay ran out. I tapped into my bank account. 2 years later, that ran out. Before you knew it, I exhausted retirement. Ended up on the streets of Miami, spent 2 years on the streets of Miami, never telling anyone in my family. Every Sunday, I would call my sister in Freeport, Long Island, and say, sis, how you doing? How's things going? How's auntie so-and-so? You know, and I just got through it on my own. I found my way back to New York City, and ashamed of my situation, looking kind of scruffy, I got to Port Authority in New York after getting a bus ticket to New York, and refused to go to Long Island and let my family see me in the condition I was in, and I was told there was a shelter across the street. 10 months later, I got myself out, but while I was in that shelter, I was organizing for better conditions in the shelter, because I thought the big thing that was being done was people's stories weren't being told. And by that I mean, we tend to paint homelessness in this country in broad strokes. You're homeless because you don't have a work history, you're lazy, you don't want to work, you don't have an education, you're a drug addict, you have mental illness. I suddenly found myself saying, I don't have any of that stuff. So, whoa. You know, I don't have any of that stuff. So even I found myself confrontational with the caseworkers who thought they had to fill out forms for me, like I didn't have an education. I said, this has to change. So I came out and I got politicized through that process. It was a transformation in life for me. But I was very open about it. I decided not to go back into computer software. I said, somebody's got to speak up on those, for those who aren't speaking up for themselves. Somebody has to empower the homeless to be a voice for the homeless. And what I found were people gravitating towards me because I told my story, being invited into spaces to speak that I'd never been in before, being invited around the world to talk about my issues. And, you know, and then I end up connecting with folks in academia particularly. I think that's what elevated my story, working with a lot of students at the Grad Center, David, Neil Smith particularly, his classes, and engaging those students, and it's just been an incredible opportunity to bond with these folks and, you know, just to learn and be able to share your story, right? Struggle, you can be transformed through your personal experiences, right? Never had a political bone in my body, I wouldn't think. But when I came out, I said, no, this stuff hasn't changed. It can't continue this way.
Were you able to finally tell your parents?
I still, to this day, my sister has passed away, but nobody in my family knows I have experienced that.
If you get enough people like this, you will.
So interesting, and also what Rob said, that people don't tell their stories enough, so
it's huge.
Yeah, and yeah, of course for me too, it's the story of my family, and it wasn't until I came and was teaching in New York City for quite a long time that I realized that a lot of people who were in political groups with me have families who were political, families who were on the left. I hadn't really met anybody who had parents on the left who came from that. And that was a very exciting thing and a new thing for me. And I still think those stories need to be out there more. For me, it's hard to say. I think I didn't grow up in a political family. I think it comes from my mother's being a Catholic. What I will thank Catholicism for is having the insight that there's something to life other than what's here every day. I would disagree what the something is from that training, but the idea of reaching beyond was a very important idea, and the rigor. And my father, who's about to turn 90 this week, my father is Methodist, and he grew up in a household where singing, dancing, playing sports, none of that was allowed. Very strict Methodist household. So between those two rigorous disciplines, and the fact that I went to a convent school, I grew up in England, in Europe, went to a convent school where we had to kneel on the ground and have Reverend Mother measure the length of our skirts from the floor so that they weren't too long, too short. The girls would roll them up and everything. I had that training. A very intensely moral training, but also training that gave a sense of transcendence and what that might be. I think that those two things combined with the just lucky opportunity of being in England at that period and falling in love with the theater. And I went to the theater every chance I got. I tried to see every single thing on every place in London when I was growing up, when you could stand in the back for 2 and 6 pence, which is about 35 cents. So I saw everything, and the theater was partly my radical education because I certainly didn't get it in school from the nuns. And I think it was those religious traditions, plus seeing my father somehow subtly but profoundly move away from the racist environment of his growing up. Somehow, and I don't know how still, my father was able to not replicate racism. And seeing that, I
think... Maybe you had something to do with it.
I don't know. I think, I don't know. But seeing that was a very powerful example.
Now that it's his 90th birthday this week, did he say to you, Barbara, if I can't dance, I don't want to be part of your revolution?
No, he did not. He still is not a dancer. He is still not a dancer. But I think that training, for me, led me to think, you know, how could you possibly go to college when people are starving? A kind of very basic thought that led me to want to join the Peace Corps and then decide to reject it because it seemed too imperialist and go to Vista instead, where I was a farm worker organizer for migrant farm workers who taught me, they taught me to dance, worked in camps with them, and knew absolutely nothing, faked knowing Spanish so I could get the job to work with them, and worked with them, and they taught me everything with incredible generosity. And maybe I'll just finish this one thing. One example of that was one of my jobs was, in the old days we used to cut a check, physically cut a check. They were sending checks back home, which is of course the whole point of working here. They worked in tobacco fields, bent over under cloths to replicate the human conditions of a real tobacco field. And we would go, and I would go alone to a camp with 800 migrant workers on Fridays to cut their checks so they could send them back home. And I was so inexperienced that one of them wanted to send $50 from his account home. And I stupidly cut the check for $5,000, not realizing that there was a self-correcting thing in the checking system that would prevent me from taking $5,000, everything he might ever have saved, and taking it out of his account. It was a Friday night. I didn't realize the mistake till that night. Of course, there were no cell phones. They had no phones, nothing. I was horrified with this terrible mistake. So as soon as the sun came up, I drove out to the camp, thinking, how could I apologize to them? How could I make this right? And they had figured out not only my mistake, but that I would arrive at sunrise, and almost all of them were lined up on the road waiting for me, telling me not to worry about it.
Well, I want to thank you all for being here for this forum, and not to trivialize your own personal stories. Sharing those stories can also change the world. Thank you so much.